We pour out our praise. Father God, thank you for this Sunday. Lord, we come before you first and foremost with hearts of gratitude. You have seen us through another week, and we stand at the start of a fresh week full of new beginnings. Lord, help us open our hearts and minds and fill us up with your word. Stir in us a deep desire to grow our relationship with you stronger. Help us to look to one another's needs before our own and to always be ready to serve those around us by the power of your love within us. Thank you, Lord, for always knowing what we need even before we know. And we say all these things in your mighty name. Amen. All right, you may be seated if you can find a seat. You know, we're just going to get friendly. We're just get to know each other already. So it's fine. We're a friendly church. Get to know everybody off the bat. We got some seats up front. Those are always the favorite of the church. So come on in the front, everybody. Come on down. Okay, my name is Nicole. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I'm going to go through a lot of announcements. I'm going to talk kind of quick, but we got a lot to cover. So here we go. First, fill out your connection card. You can do this digitally. If you go back really quick, Tom, awesome, thank you. You can scan the QR code right here above me with your phone, and then you can fill out a digital connection card, or you can use the paper one that we handed to you today. This lets us know that you're here. This lets us know a service you attended, and then on the back you can fill out for any prayer requests or anything that you need. It's a great way to get it straight into Pastor Scott's hands. So feel free to fill that out. Okay, next, stick six. So if it is your first time here, welcome to the Bridge Church in Corona first. I know I've already said that, but we're going to say it again. And we invite you to attend our services at least six different times. And the reason we really say stick six is that each service is going to be just a little bit different. So you're going to experience something just a little bit different. You might meet somebody new. And so this just really is a great way for you to get to know us better as a church and decide if this is going to be your home church. And so come on back six different times. Okay, obviously after you do that, you're going to be like, Bridge Church in Corona is my home church, clearly. So if once you make that decision, you can join our First Steps partnership. And so this is a class where you're really just going to get kind of a little bit deeper into our understandings of a church. You're going to meet with Pastor Scott and have some lunch and discuss all things about Bridge Church Corona. You can register for this on our Church Center app. So if you need any questions, I'll actually be outside after service. I can help you with any of that. All right, so next, graduation Sunday, June 2nd. All right. We always love graduation Sunday. This is just a time that we get to really celebrate our little graduates. I have some fingers moving around in the front row saying, like, yeah, me. We have some fifth graders that are going into middle school. We have some high schoolers that are going to be graduating. We have sixth graders going into middle school. You know, we have college graduates. Let us celebrate you on June 2nd. So you can submit your registration through our Church Center app, and this will allow you to come on up here on June 2nd, and we get to just take some time to say good job and congratulations. So we're excited for that. Okay, Father's Day, June 16th, right? Let's give it a round for our fathers, our father figures in our life. Okay, come on down, celebrate that day at the Bridge Church in Corona. We're going to do that through, obviously, dad jokes and donuts. So, you know, pocket those good dad jokes, get them ready, okay? We're going to invite them all that day. Just let it go, dads. This is your time to shine, okay? All right, so Summer Blast 2024. It is time, everybody. This is it, okay? This, I'm going to read this because I got a lot. It is July 24th to 26th from 5 to 7:30. Okay. This event is for kids ages 4 to 12. Now, the only real kind of mandatory thing is that kids do need to be potty trained. Our registration is $10 per child or $15 for two or $20 for three. Okay. You're going to max out at $20. So if you have more than three, just bring them all. We do have sponsorships available. So if you have any questions about that, you can see myself. You can see Darla, she's always around. Just grab one of us and we can help you with that. You can email us to our emails on our website. We're going to have water activities, games, snacks, dancing, singing. Kids absolutely love it. You can scan the scan to register QR code here to get your kids to sign up. This side. Yeah, thank you. And then what goes along with that is volunteers, okay? So right now we have 4 volunteers, you guys. We're going to have 80 kids. Okay, we got 4 volunteers right now. So our ask is to have, 5 volunteers now. All right, thanks 8:30 service. 5 volunteers, we're shooting for 80 kids. So we need people to dedicate their time, okay? Well, this is going to be for our kids. They're going to be having a great time and building their relationship with Jesus. So you can scan that QR code to volunteer and help out serve, whether it be through an activity center, just helping us overall. We're going to need lots of it. All right. In addition to volunteers, we are going to need donations, okay? This is, there's multiple ways to donate. So we have a sign-up sheet in the lobby if you're interested in just bringing food items, okay, because every day the kids get a snack. But also, if you just feel more comfortable with doing a cash donation, yes, we still accept cash in this world. But, you know, I'm a digital girly, so you can scan that QR code, and that'll take you to our PushPay account. We also have Zelle, but we can take check, really cash, anything, okay? We need donations, guys. We're going to create a really special moment, and for our kids, I think it's worth it. We are looking to raise at least $3,000, so if it is in your heart to dedicate this time to our kids, then please do so. All right, lastly, don't miss a thing, guys. Our digital bulletin, scan the QR code. You're going to want it weekly. This lets you know what's going on within the church walls and also an easy way for you to sign up for all the things because clearly you want to donate, right? And clearly you want to volunteer. So scan that, and then you can get connected easily. All right, we're going to say hi to someone new. Kids, hold tight. We'll release you in a little bit. We have something a little extra special today. Thank you.
That one. Miracle. Good morning, Bridge Church. I know we got a lot of people in here right now. Let's take our seats. We want to honor the fallen troops this morning. We're going to start things a little differently. I invited my brother up here, Sean. He's going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, but before we do that, I just have to say something. I asked if he could wear some of his gear and stuff, and he got rid of all of it, okay? He actually got rid of everything. And he kind of panicked when I texted him on Monday, and then he sold it all to this place in Fullerton, you said?
Yes, sir.
To a place in Fullerton, so then he decided to go back and see if we could get. His uniform was still there. That's right, the one he wore in Iraq, where he served in Iraq. He just said, oh, you couldn't hear him. He said miracle, and I totally agree. So please, let's stand up. Go ahead, Shad, take over.
Please rise. Everybody face to your right, my left. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Keep standing real fast. We're going to do a, yes. Keep standing. We're going to do a moment of silence for the fallen soldiers. Heavenly Father, we lift up to you in prayer today the soldiers that have gone on before us, sacrificing their own lives for our protection, sacrificing their lives for our safety, and sacrificing their lives for our freedom. We are grateful for their service. May they continue to inspire us to live selflessly in our own lives as Christ Jesus tells us to do. Let's pray for the families today of those who have the fallen soldiers, the loved ones, the brothers, the sisters, the mothers, the fathers, the cousins, the friends. Lord, their lives were not taken in vain. Thank you for the freedom that we get to experience every single day here in America. In Jesus Christ's name, we all pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sean. So to get this thing going, hope everyone can find a seat. I'm going to release the kids. Kids, get out. Maybe some more seat. Not you, Efren. So I have to start with saying something. I'm involved with other pastors online, pastors all over the world, and mostly nationally. And we were writing in a forum this week, and one of the pastors said, "Remember, don't get upset this weekend, pastors. It's Memorial Day weekend." Because typically this weekend is the slowest weekend, or one of the slowest weekends, besides Father's Day, ironically, that people don't show up to church. Well, I can tell you right now that all those guys are wrong today. So I will be reporting back to them. You're wrong. Take a picture. People love God in Corona. People love God in Temescal Valley. That's what I know. All right, so today we're starting a new sermon series, and what we're going to do together in our time over the next few weeks is we're going to look at the names of God. Last week, we kind of started this. We looked at the name that Jesus referred to himself often, Son of Man. Now, today, we're going to take us back to the beginning, and a name that maybe you've heard before in church, maybe you've read it in your Bible, Yahweh. We're going to look at what that name means. But to get going, I want to start with a question. What do Christians mean when we use that word, God? Because there's quite a lot of fogginess for people in America when they use this word, God. So many people will say, "I'm spiritual, I believe in a higher being," right? And they use this word God just as this catch-all phrase for a higher power. Now, before I was a Christian, people would use this word God, and oftentimes for me, it seemed like it would be interchangeable. You could use God just for pretty much anything, or any God for that matter, a divine creator, like, okay, but kind of the same for Muslims and Buddhists and Mormons and the like. And it all just kind of ties together, God. Now, I wasn't dumb enough to think that they were all the same, but it just kind of seemed like people would throw the word God out there, and it just meant something spiritual. I really needed this sermon series when I first became a Christian. In America, you watch media with TV and movies, even in politics and so on, you get this word God, and it gets brought up quite often. And it seems to be this general assumption that we all know what we're talking about, and we all maybe mean kind of the same thing, I guess. But for us Christians, we need to begin to discipline our thinking and think carefully and intentionally about who we are referring to when we use this word and hear this word, God. You know, America, we just talked right now about the home of the brave and the land of the free, and I feel blessed to grow up living here and grow up going to a school where you have different ethnic groups and cultural backgrounds and different religious backgrounds. You could have a Chinese Buddhist friend. You could have a Catholic friend from Boston. You could have a Hindu friend from New Jersey, a Mormon friend from Utah, and it's a beautiful thing. What's interesting is we have only one English word to say God. And there's no way we can all mean the same thing when we use that English word, God. So we need to gain clarity. And that's what today is going to be all about. How do we gain clarity on who this God that we worship is? So I have this example. Hello, my name is Scott. Hello, Efren. Hello. How many Scots do you think are in the city of Corona alone? A lot. Thousands. You are correct. I've been trying to study this. There is a lot of Scots in Corona. Thousands. Is there any Scott in this room right now? Maybe last name, middle name. Any Scots in here? That's okay, because upstairs there is a Scott, my son, okay? And he goes to this church. That's his first name, Scott. So, two Scots just at this church alone. What about Hayden? My last name. Is there any Haydens in Corona, you think? Is there any Haydens in Corona? Yeah, I guess my parents are here going, raising their hand already. I hadn't got to that question yet. Hold on. I just mean in Corona, thousands. Okay, is there any Haydens in this room today, Mom and Dad? Okay, thank you. So we have Haydens here also. So it's safe to say the word Scott or Hayden is not going to be helpful to completely identify me, because it's the same word that others have in Corona or others have just even in this church alone. In fact, I know another Hayden who's upstairs right now in Kidsbridge. And like I told First Service, when they become of age, I am going to be matchmaker, okay? I'm going to get Hayden, the little girl, involved with my youngest son, Benny Hayden, and then they can marry each other, and they're going to be Hayden, Hayden. And don't think it's weird. Everybody online's like, oh, this is a weird church. No, it's just a plan I have, okay? It's just a plan I have. But okay, let's say, oh, I like Scott. Well, which one? Which one? Are you referring to Scott in Corona, Scott in Fontana? You know, what Scott are you talking about? The one at the bridge? Are you talking about my son? Same word and name. How do we gain clarity on which Scott you're talking about? Maybe the first and last name, bring them together. However, after I did a Google search for Scott Hayden just in Corona, thousands again. Thousands of Scott Haydens, and the most famous Scott Hayden is this ragtime composer that I'm really into now, okay? Because his name's Scott Hayden. So how would you further clarify what Scott Hayden you are talking about? What would you do to figure this out? The easiest way is to tell my story, is to know my story. Not just my name. There's 1,000 Scots in Corona, thousands of Scots in the world. How do you know it's me? You tell a story. You know my story. So this is Scott, who grew up in Norco, right? Met his wife in high school, went on to be in some silly pop punk band that people at the church just can't stop watching on YouTube for some reason, even though I tell them to stop looking for it. And now this Scott is leading a church in Temescal Valley and so forth. So you gain this story. You tell someone's story. That's how we identify people, by someone's name and by someone's story. This is what we do to figure out who we're talking about. It's funny that we never think like this and use these same type of categories and ideas when it comes to this word, God. Who is this God people will bring up? So what God are we talking about? Well, I guess it would help to know God's story to help us identify what particular God we're talking about. Who is our God? And lucky for us, and we're so blessed, we have God's story right here, don't we? Now, the first sentence of the Bible, and this might be helpful for us, Genesis 1:1. It reads, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. First line. What is the title for God in the first sentence of the Bible? God. Pretty easy. It's God. Now, what is the Hebrew word for God? The Hebrew word for God that we're reading really here is the word Elohim. Okay? Elohim. It's a title. It's not just a name. But there's something interesting we can talk about here. If that's the only thing you've ever read in the Bible, if the first time today you've never read scripture before and you just read 1:1 of Genesis, you've already learned something. We've already narrowed down the list of when it comes to God. In this first sentence, we're talking about a God who has the power to create and to spin the universe into being. And that takes a whole lot of other deities off the list right away. They're gone. Because not all gods that people describe throughout history could do that kind of thing. So the first sentence in the Bible narrows down the list already to which God we're talking about. Not entirely. You still don't know exactly what God we're talking about here, but it's narrowing it down. It's like cluing it in. So what do we do next? As Christians, we've developed this discipline of reading the Bible, of reading what it says and what God's story is. So now to learn the name and the story of our God, a good place to go, and some of you here that have been Christians a long time know exactly where I'm going to Exodus. We're going to go start at Exodus chapter 2, verse 23 through 25. It reads this. During that long period, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out, and their cry for help because of their slavery went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. I understand. We just jumped into the middle of a story. God is still being referred to here, translated as Elohim. Still, same thing. And you may not even have read this before. You don't know the names. We have Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. They must be important. But without even knowing who these people are, without even having any sort of historical context, this scripture lets us know something right off the bat. Our God hears us and sees us. Our God heard them and saw them. Our God hears us and sees us. Even if this was your first time reading the scriptures, now you know, okay, this is a personal God. He hears us and he sees us. This is a living God. He's not a dead God. He's a living God. He hears us and he sees us. This is a loving God. He hears us and he sees us and he's concerned about us. It's a God heard their grumbling. How often do you grumble? It's a good thought to think about. Makes you maybe a little happy to know that God's listening, or maybe a little scared, depending on what you grumble about. But if you've ever prayed, God help me. God help me. I am overwhelmed. I am discouraged. I don't know if I can keep going on. God heard you, and that is exactly the kind of prayer God wants to hear from us. Do you ever feel under attack? Tell God. Tell God. He hears you. That's what the scripture is telling us. He hears you. Do you ever feel like you have no energy whatsoever? Tell God. He hears you. Do you ever feel rejected and lonely and abandoned? Tell God. He hears you. It's very easy. So you have the permission to dump everything you're feeling right now onto the Lord. Whatever it is, financial trouble, a diagnosis you received, an outburst that you let out that you wish you hadn't, tell God. He hears you. That's what the scripture just said. He heard the Israelites. So God hears his people. When people put their faith in God, they become his people. We are his people. And he hears us. But sometimes being honest with God can be intimidating. I understand that. You might even pretend he doesn't already know everything about your life. Newsflash, he does. He knows what's going on in your thoughts even right now. He listens. God loves to listen to you. This God is a listening God. You know, you may get too busy for a conversation with him, but he never is too busy for a conversation with you, ever. And he doesn't have a short attention span. Maybe like your spouse when they say, oh, sorry, I wasn't listening. What? I was watching the game. What? That's not what God does. God is attentive. Then the scripture says that our God looks and he's concerned. He looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. You know what that tells me? The God that I follow, that I love, that I need in my life, he is aware and he cares. He is aware and he cares about my life. He loves you more than you can understand. Yeah, but my kids, man, they are struggling, and it's painful on my heart to watch this. Can't you see what's going on down here, Lord? Can't you see? Are you even looking? But God, the doctor's report has come back. Don't you see what's going on in my life? Can't you see? but I'm in pain every single day. Can't you see what's going on down here, Lord? Can't you see? Are you even looking? Do you guys realize what we just read in the scriptures? The Israelites were crying out to God, crying out, yeah, but the slavery we are in, Lord. Don't you see what's going on down here? Are you even looking? Put that into perspective. These were slaves in Egypt. And guess what? This God was looking and he was concerned. Our God heard them and saw them and was concerned. So that tells me our God hears us and he's concerned about us. So now we've learned together that our God can bring things into existence. We've learned that this God is a personal God and a living God. We've learned that this God hears us, he sees us, he loves us. And I'm going to tell you right now, I don't want to keep repeating myself, but this separates our God from a lot of other people's faith, that they put, the things they put their faith in. Right there, just that alone separates us from them when it comes to our God and how personal our God is. Let's keep going. Exodus chapter 3. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. He had led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So the next guy in our story here, we got this guy Moses, and he's cruising along with his flock. He comes to this mountain and he meets an angel of not Elohim. Who's this angel of? It says, Lord, all caps. If you have your Bible out or your phone out, it's all caps. The Lord is in all capitals. Why did they do that? This is your English translators giving you a little clue into the Hebrew word used here. And it's not just another word for master or lowercase Lord. It's actually the divine name that's going to be revealed, Yahweh. So now the story is about to reveal the name and the meaning of the name. So the angel of Yahweh appears to Moses. Let's keep going. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. So here is another way that this story is trying to shape our view of the character and attributes of this Yahweh God. And that is, our God is holy. Now, I know this could be confusing for a lot, especially new Christians, this word holy. You might sing about it in the church. You might have heard people say holy before. And you're like, that sounds nice. I don't even know what it means. Holy in this context means unique and different and set apart. So this God, our God, is utterly other, and he's unique and he's transcendent. That our God has within his own self the resources to spin the universe into being, the creativity to set the stars in the sky. The holiness of our God is unparalleled, and his being is just blameless and faultless and unblemished. Moral purity, that purity word's a big deal here. In the scripture we just read, don't come any closer, God says. Take off your sandals. This is holy ground. And maybe you're thinking, that's weird. Why can't Moses just walk a little bit closer to this bush? God's presence is so powerful and so pure. Moses's unpureness, I don't know if that's a word, his impurities, okay? His impurities would be dangerous to be put on this pure and unique ground. And I still know that's difficult to understand, so I have this fun little idea, an example for you. Let's say Moses comes over to your house and you just had your carpets cleaned, okay? And the carpets are nice and fresh and smell nice and they're pure. And I don't know if you ever call your carpets pure, but for today's example, you'd call your carpets pure, okay? And not only would you ask Moses to take off his little sandals, you would insist that he takes those sandals off. Take off those gross sandals, Moses. Not just because you had your carpets cleaned, but also because of what we just read. Moses is out there cruising along with this flock of sheep. If you don't know this, sheep are dirty. Sheep are dirty. So he is stepping with his sandals into some pretty gross stuff. Maybe some sheep pee. I want to keep this PG. Maybe some sheep droppings. He's stepping all over the place. And this is just a fun example. Our God is pure and holy. Moses just can't go trampling on into this holy ground with his sheep sandals on. And I'm really talking about a carpet right now. God says, don't come any closer. Take off those sandals. Our God is utterly unique and set apart and different and pure. See, we're learning more and more about this God and his story now. He's not just any God. There's something special here. So God further clarifies his identity here in verse 6. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And we'll continue on. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. If it's our stories that reveal who we are individually, what is this story revealing about the character of Yahweh? This God cares. He cares deeply about humans treat each other. And when there is oppression, when there is evil, when there is injustice, this God cares. Our God internalizes the pain and the grief and is driven to do something about it. 10 through 12. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses is like, who am I? I don't know. I don't know if I'm the right candidate for this. I'm not qualified. I don't even actually really want to do this. I can't even walk on the ground over here without my shoes on. Who am I that I should go? And God says something very powerful here. Please listen. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter. What matters is who he is. And he is with us. That's our next fill-in here. Our God is with us. And when he says this, is God saying he'll be with us in 5 minutes, right? He'll be with us soon, and he has the call waiting, you know, music on the phone? No. It means I am with you and will continue to be with you. God's not saying in the future one day, I'll be with you. He's saying, here I am, I have been here, and from here on out, I will be with you. And yet again, another character trait of this Yahweh God. And we can look around us in the world today and we can see that it is super screwed up. There's messed up things happening. You might feel like God doesn't care or he doesn't have a sense of what's going on in our lives. And I know a lot of us can feel that way. And you go, God, where are you? This is crazy around me here. And maybe you think God just kind of lets the universe just do its own thing. He created it, and now he's on his perpetual vacation, and occasionally he'll come and, you know, give a couple people some prayers answered, maybe one or two. That is not the story of Yahweh. That is not what we're reading today. In fact, it's the exact opposite. Our God is with us. He has not abandoned us. He has not left us, and he's here with us right now. That's what God's saying. And God honors his commitment to be with his people, even if they are in deep suffering. And in this case, the Israelites, slavery. This now leads us to his name. I love this stuff. Okay, here we go. Our God is who he is. It's an easy feeling. Is. 13 through 14. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. I am who I am. This is famous stuff, church. Famous stuff. And I was so confused the first time I ever read it. What is going on here? God is saying, I am whatever it is that I am. I am, that's my name. Now, this is a very profound and powerful thing that he's saying. Maybe you've heard this phrase before, I am who I am, and you think, oh, that sounds cool, that sounds philosophical, I like that. And then you just keep reading, you just keep moving past it. No, you have to stop. It's actually not that philosophical at all. It's actually deeply, deeply meaningful and showing a personal character statement about Yahweh. Who is this God that we say we worship here in this church? What is God saying here? Whatever character traits or whatever attributes that God displays, he is that. Let me explain. If he says, I am merciful, God is the perfect definition of mercy. He is whatever he is. He is merciful. So he is the perfect embodiment and the most consistent, reliable mercy that you will find anywhere in the universe. I'm going to keep going with more words here. He says, I am grace. He is the perfect definition of grace. Our God is the perfect embodiment and the most consistent, reliable grace you will find in the universe. If our God says in the Bible, I am justice, he is the perfect embodiment and the exact thing we need when it comes to reliability with justice that you will find anywhere in this universe. When he says, I am love, he is the perfect definition of love. He is the perfect embodiment and the most consistent, reliable source of love that you will find anywhere in this universe. He is who he is. He is who he is, and that's what it's getting at here in this scripture. And that is a contrast to you and I. That's because you and I are only sometimes what we are. And I'm going to self-deprecate right now for a second. Oh, Pastor Scott, he's such a nice guy. Sometimes. If you are out with me and my two boys and we're doing youth sports or I'm coaching youth sports, I am that guy, okay? I am that guy. Are you blind, ref? Are you blind? Everyone can see it. That was a foul. See, I'm nice sometimes. The last service, I threw someone's name in there, and I thought it was actually really mean, so I didn't do it to this service. That's right. I'm only nice sometimes. If you're dating someone and you're like, oh my goodness, he's the most amazing man. He's so incredible, and he's so generous, and he's so clean. And then you marry him and you realize that he's only sometimes generous and sometimes amazing and sometimes clean. And that's okay. That's what it means to be a human. We are only sometimes what we say we are or what we are. Yahweh, he is what he is. You see the difference? That's the idea here. You can depend on a human sometimes to be what they are. You can always depend on Yahweh to be who he is. You never have to worry about Yahweh all of a sudden changing the rules on you or kind of being somebody else. Yahweh is all about Yahweh. You always know where you stand with this God. He keeps his word. I am who I am. That's what that means. Let's keep going. 3:15. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me for generation to generation. So this is the story that has the foundational implications and the revelation of God's name. Now I want to go forward in the story a little bit, forward in the story of God and the Israelites, and I love this so much. I'm so excited. Jesus comes onto the scene. Who is Jesus? Matthew 1:21. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Now, why in the world am I giving a scripture that we mostly read at Christmas? This is where it all comes together for us Christians here, everybody. We have this angel, gives us very good gospel news. He tells Mary this name that he wants to give the baby. And what Matthew did here to include that, this is very intentional for the readers. I've talked about this before, but it's so important. You would pronounce this baby's name in Hebrew, Yehoshua. Say it with me. Yehoshua. Yehoshua. Okay? Now, I want to break this down a little bit. Yehoshua. Let's do the last part first. Shoah, Yehoshua, Shoah, that's the Hebrew root word for to save. Save. Now, get ready. The first part. The meaning of Yehoshua, Yahweh, it's an abbreviated form of the name Yahweh. So let's put the meanings of those names together now. What does it say? Yahweh comes to save his people. See, mouths should just drop right now. Anyone that read that now knows, oh, whoa. We have Yahweh, Yehoshua to save, now to save. This is full circle, church. I love the Bible, okay? This is full circle of theology here. And Jesus, in both of his teachings and his symbolic actions, is walking around the place acting as if he's Yahweh. He's walking around and saying things in the culture that only Yahweh had the prerogative to say. And in this cultural setting, he's sending a loud and clear signal to everybody about the claim of who he was making himself to be. In the beginning of this message, I asked, how would you clarify a person? By their name, by their story. Don't you just love this? There was a story just in Jesus Christ's name. Just in Jesus' name, Yahweh saves. Yahweh, he is who he is. I am who I am, will save us from our sins. And then we have the way that Jesus saves us through his actions. And this has been planned from the beginning. And this is a God that I follow and that I love and I desire. And I claim my allegiance to him. Because guess what? He is who he is. He is who he is. And the Apostle Paul saw the same stuff going on and wrote it down for us, 1 Corinthians 8:6. He said, yet for us there is but one God, a Father, from whom all things came and for whom we live. And there is but one Lord Jesus Christ, and he says it again, through whom all things came and through whom we live. This is who our God is. Jesus, Yahweh, saves. Yahweh saves. So we are a church full of people who believe this God, not just some English word God, but see, our God means the Father revealed in the Son, Jesus Christ, who is empowered by the Spirit, working together to bring about the redemption of the broken and sinful world. And this God is so committed to being with his people, he not only just sent a deliverer, he actually becomes a human being in the person of the Son, empowered by the love of the Spirit, so that he could absorb the pain and the sin and the guilt and all the wreckage that we've caused in this world. And this God takes it into himself on the cross so that we can overcome it, and he conquers it with his love. So our God, take this away today. Our God is alive. Our God is living and he sees us. Our God hears us and he loves us. Our God is holy and set apart and different and unique. Our God will always be with us, not 5 minutes from now, but right now. And our God will never change who he is. That's what we do, but he will never change who he is. And his name is Jesus Christ, the name above all names. Amen. Let's stand in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now to say thank you. Thank you for this time of fellowship. Thank you for your word in the Bible, Lord. Thank you for giving us your name and saying, I am who I am. Thank you for never changing and being constant yesterday, today, and tomorrow. That you never change, that even though if we may change and we might have our flaws and we're not always who we are sometimes, we're so thankful that we can rely on you, the constant, the rock, the cornerstone. That you are that for us. If there's anyone in this room right now that has been struggling, that they feel like they're not heard by God, they're not seen by God, I pray today that you see that you are. That you are heard and you are seen. If you feel like God's not with you right now, I pray today that you know that God is with you always. I pray today that you know the name of God, Yahweh, is I am who I am. And if you feel like, are you keep changing on me, Lord, and you keep changing the rules, we know now from Scripture, he doesn't. He is who he is, and he's the perfect definition of his amazing attributes. If there's anyone in this room right now that has lost somebody, maybe someone has left their life on bad terms or brokenness or heartache, I want to pray for them right now. Lord, lift them up, be with them. Show them that you are the stable one. Show them that even though they feel like they've lost a love, they can count on your love. Even though they feel like maybe they weren't given a gracious chance from somebody else, let them know that they can lean on you because you are perfectly gracious. Let us here as a church and those online know that you are good. No matter what's going on around us in this world, you are consistent and you are good. Lord, again, I want to pray for the fallen soldiers. They did not die in vain. They gave us this freedom. We are here this morning worshiping God in Southern California because the freedom that we have because they went overseas or they were right here and they died in battle. We want to thank you for that, Lord. We want to thank you for their lives. Be with their family. This weekend's not just about barbecues. This weekend's not just about hanging out with their family. It's about what the freedom that we have in America because of what the soldiers did for each and every single one of us. And the ultimate sacrifice came from Jesus Christ. You are the ultimate sacrifice. Help us live in always recognizing that. In Jesus' name we all pray. Amen. I'm going to call the praise band up here right now. We're going to be passing out our tithing baskets. Thank you for being so generous here to the Bridge Church. We have big plans at this church, and I just hope that and I pray that you can get behind this. And there's a few ways to do that with your time, talents, and treasures. We have a lot of people here giving their time. Some people stay here all three services. We have a lot of people giving also their treasure. And that means that's between them and God. It is. But when it comes down to it, in this community, what we're trying to do here is spread God's word through Temescal Valley, through the community of Corona. We're trying to grow in that way, not just to grow for numbers, but to grow for God and to show the world who God is. And I think we need more of that in Temescal Valley. And I thank for the family of believers. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for the other churches around us. But it takes us. It takes us, God's people, to come around and give their time, talents, and treasures. Also, the prayer team will be ready to take any prayers. If you have something going on in your life, come on up. The prayer team can pray over you. God bless. Have a great rest of your long weekend, or if you're retired, every weekend's a long weekend, right? It's pretty nice. Enjoy, and God bless.
for being who you are, Jesus. God bless you guys. Have a great week.